So, in the last class, we were discussing this funding problem of myself making the gauge theory passage equivalent better defined in the continuum limit. And we come to the conclusion that the path integral dA over the volume of the gauge group, this thing that we call integral d omega, could equally be written written as d mu d v dc, where b and c were both adjoint values. Both adjoint values and commutative fields. Okay? Exponential of IS okay, plus B A delta F F A B C B. Okay, times delta function of F.
So what do you mean by adjoint value?
Adjoint value meaning there is one B or one C. You know, they have these indices. They graph the value, but they have indices. And these indices are in one-to-one correspondence with the indices of the Lie action. Okay? That's really okay. I shouldn't have said adjoint value. You're right. That's misleading. Just that there are as many FA functions as there were elements of the group of the Lie action. Okay. So there's you remember what the purpose of this FA was? FA was an object that was going to fix the gauge invariance. FA equals zero. Gave you one point cut in the orbit of every gauge group. Okay? Now, how many gauge transformations did we have? Gauge transformations were labeled by group elements, or infinitesimally, by Lie algebra elements. So, if we're going to fix these gauge transformations, we need as many conditions as there are group elements. So, we need R functions of space-time to be set to zero, where R is the rank of the gauge group. Okay, number of generators. Is this clear? So the U1 theory, we need one condition, because the rank is 1. And SU2 theory, we need 3 conditions, because the rank is 3. Is this clear? 3 functions. And these indices here, in F, okay, this index here was a which condition index? This index here was a gauge transformation. Because the number of conditions was equal to the number of gauge transformations, this was a square matrix. So it makes sense to talk about its determinant. And this determinant, yeah. So what I really meant to say is that A and B are just indices labeling the generators of the gauge. Is this clear?
In
what?
In electrodynamics. We have the visibility go mu equal 0.
Yes.
But then we still have
residual gauge
transformation.
Yes. But you know, the residual gauge transformation is a function of fewer variables.
Okay.
Okay? So on this bit, you know, this counting of how many things is a bit imprecise, because what you're doing is counting functions.
Right.
Okay? So in that counting, if you have a function of 4 variables, compared to that, any function of 3 variables is counted as 0. Why do you think? Why should we think that way? For instance, take any function of 4 variables, a Taylor expandent in the 4th variable. There are an infinite number of coefficients. Only one of them is the 0. Okay? So when I'm doing this counting, I mean counting as a function of 4 variables. It's of course very imprecise, yeah, because you have to regulate the counting. But roughly speaking. Is this clear? Any other questions about this? Any questions about the procedure used to get this formula? Was it clear to everyone last class? Okay? Great. So let's move on. So let's study let's move on by studying one example of such a gauge condition. The example we'll study is the one that was just alluded to, but it's to be studied anyway. For instance, let's study an example where FA is equal to A mu. Okay, why this condition? Well, this condition is sort of nice because it's Lorentz invariant. Okay. You can imagine many other conditions. For instance, you can set A0 equals 0, which is sometimes a useful condition. It's called temporal gauge. Or you can, there are various other things you can do. And these other things are sometimes useful. In my own research, I've often found it more useful when you've got a non-trivial problem to use a non-Lorentz invariant gauge. Then it's Lorentz. But for the purpose of generating perturbation theory, for instance, this is clearly a very convenient gauge because it preserves the symmetries of the block problem in the Lorentz. Okay. Now, let us now compute. Hey, another question that you might have had is, well, why not put, you know, d mu maybe? Whatever that means. So what that might mean. The following. You might think perhaps it would be more like an actual good gauge condition, which is d mu minus I a mu commutator. Suppose we define d mu as this. This would be the covariant derivative when acting on an adjoint field. Now the gauge field is not quite adjoint value, it's the inhomogeneous transformations. But still, part of it structural thing, adjoints. You might think perhaps this is slightly more natural gauge condition to put. Why not put that? Now the answer to this question is what? Suppose we did put this condition, how would it differ from the condition I just put?
So is this condition not Lorentz?
Well, it's a very important to see something. Fine. But let me take you. So let me regard A mu as equal to A T A, as we always do. And now let me work out D mu A mu. Okay? So d mu a mu is equal to d mu a mu plus or minus I a mu commutator. Which is it? Okay? So there's no difference between these two. Just because commutator of any matrix with itself is 0. This metric, of course, the metric lets us use is either plus minus. Okay? So there's no difference. So let's work with this condition. Okay. Now, let us try to be a bit concrete here. And to try to compute this coast action. By the way, these fields here are called coasts. This B field and C field. And sometimes conventional called B.
I'm sorry,
sir.
Why should you say that
the commutator of any matrix with itself vanishes?
But
in
the most general sense, A mu, A t, A m, A mu, B t, B, and the commutator of T b is not true.
So what you're looking at is the example of the fact that you can take an obvious fact and make it look confusing. But it's still true. So let's see. What you're saying is that, look, suppose I've got some matrix.
BB. Yeah.
This is equal to BB minus BB, so it's 0. Now, B might happen to be sum over A, C, A, B, A, where these are some other matrices. But it won't stop this from being 0.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, other questions or comments? By the way, you could, of course, I mean, it was a good question, it was not my intention. It was a serious comment that, you know, you should always, when trying to understand something, look for the simplest way about it. You could work out that it's 0 by expanding as well. And you'll find it. But there's no need to do that. Okay, yep. Okay. So, now let's look at this condition. Let's look at this condition and work out the coast action for this condition. Okay? So we've got IF, Now, what was del FABC? It was given by the condition that under a gauge transformation labeled by epsilon B, delta FB is equal to this del FAB, del FAB plus FX is equal to del FAB X minus Y epsilon B of Y. This was our definition. This was our definition of our delta FABC. The stated in plain English, delta FABC is the coefficient of the transformation of FA under a gauge transformation.
What is it calculated
with? No, okay. Sorry. I just wrote the X comma. Whatever it happens. Of course, we choose the translation here.
Yeah,
it depends on the condition. Okay, so now all we have to do is to understand how A changes under the gauge transformation. Okay, well, we know how A changes under the gauge transformation. Delta AB is equal to the change of the covariant derivative on an infinite of the gauge transformation parameter. Okay, so delta A mu is equal to d mu of epsilon. When I'm using the notation where I look at the whole matrix A rather than its components. Okay? So now by the way, look, this is at some position. This is at the same position. Nonetheless, this kernel matrix has a slightly non-trivial dependence on X and Y because there's a derivative. Do you understand? This is not an ultra-local expression. It's not like the change in A and X depends only on epsilon and X. It depends only on epsilon in the neighborhood of X. But there's some non-trivialty. Okay? Fine. Now, so from this, of course, we can deduce what this delta F will be. It will involve some covariant derivative of some delta function. Okay? But we don't really even care about what delta F is. Because what we really want is this action. Okay? How do we get this action? We get this action in the following way. What we do is replace epsilon by C. Okay? And all we have to do is the following. So I'll give you the answer and then you see it. Makes sense? All we have to do is to trace B D mu C. That's the answer. Okay, why? Yeah, so I'm saying that from the fact that you know that delta A mu is d mu of epsilon, it follows immediately that the cost action is trace B d mu C. Okay? Let's understand this. The only confusing thing about this is that this is written in with indices up here, and I've written the final answer in some compact matrix condition. Okay? So first, in order to understand this, let's work this out in indices. Okay? This, of course, is just delta A mu of A is equal to d mu epsilon A. I'm saying nothing. I'm looking at the coefficients of dA on both sides. Okay? So, now, epsilon here is some epsilon A dA. So we just replace that by CA dA. That's clear, right? Okay? And then, of course, we have to multiply here by a B. B A. I'm sorry. Suppose I call epsilon B T B. Then we just replace that epsilon by C B. Why? Because that's the rule here. This is exactly, you see, what was the rule? The rule was that F, the change in F under a gauge transformation, has this epsilon here. This operator has C in place of epsilon. Okay, so C here was just precisely the infinitesimal gauge transformation. Okay, but what we're also supposed to do is to put a BA with this A here. Well, there's an easy way of doing that in matrix notation. Because in matrix notation, delta A A was equal to delta AA PA. Okay? Now, if I want to get BA delta A, the easy way of doing it is to take B delta A twice. Because where we use the fact that we've chosen a basis in which trace of BA dt is equal to delta A. You see? Just substitute it. This is trace of BA dA. This is delta AC dC. And then I use the trace form. Why is this formula true, you're asking?
No, that's fine. The button, I would think that you found delta F A and then replace epsilon by C in that.
Ah, oh, I'm very sorry. Yes, you see, I skipped a step. I'm sorry. Yeah, sorry, I missed a step. Thank you. Sorry for that. So what you have to do is now find delta F A. Right? But delta F A was just a derivative of this.
Yeah.
Okay? So this is B mu, I'm sorry. I missed that. You're absolutely right. I just missed it. Okay. Since I messed it up, let me do it. Let me start again. Just let me do it. Okay, what was, first let's do some abstract stuff, okay, suppose I know what, so delta, we call this FA, one condition for every atomic nucleus, okay, instead we can think of it as F is equal to 0, where F is equal to FA, this is the same thing as FA equals 0 for all F. Because the coefficient of every dA must match. Okay? Now, suppose it's true that under a gauge transformation, del F, okay, is equal to something, we call this, something times epsilon. Suppose that would be. Claiming that the Hardy-Pocock determinant is simply B, that's something, times C twice. This is the first abstract claim. Firstly, you understand the claim? Do you understand what I mean by it? Secondly, do you understand why it's true? Now, just to make this totally concrete, let me take the example and to work it out. Okay? So, our F here was d mu a mu was equal to 0. That was what F was. Now what is delta F? In order to find delta F, I did a side step and then I forgot to actually compute delta F. So I computed that delta a mu was equal to d mu was equal to d mu epsilon. This we know to be true. Therefore delta F is simply d mu of epsilon. Is this clear? So now what's our general rule? Suppose we have a gauge transformation like this. Then the Hardy-Pocock determinant, we replace the epsilon by a C. We put a B behind it and take the trace. That's what this formula is. Is this clear? Okay? And so what we have to do is to take trace B d mu d mu of C. In this particular case, that's the value. Is this totally clear? Any questions about it? Is the fact that this rule, that this to this, the same as this, is that clear? Okay? So, in the particular case of the Lorentz gauge, Now I'm clearing this out. In the particular case of Lorentz gauge, we have that the path integral becomes dA mu, dB, dC, exponential of pi ST, whatever the action happened to be. In this case, it's set mu nu amplitude. It doesn't matter. Okay. Plus BA delta, plus B d mu C press. And then we've got this delta outside the exponential of FA of B. FA was d mu. Now, in order to generate perturbation theory, it is useful not to have this delta function explicitly done. In this particular case, by the way, if you work with a0 equals 0 each, then we would just use the delta function to set a0 equal to 0. Okay? But here, since this is a non-local delta function, in order to solve this condition, we would have to solve an equation in terms of some data. That's not convenient for formal purposes. Okay? So it's conventional to take this delta function and rewrite it in an integral representation. So this delta function, of course, is the same thing as exponential d, I think it's called, people normally call it b, capital b, I think people normally call it capital b, e to the power I trace b d mu a. D mu, D mu. Yeah, D mu. Okay. If done this way, now we've got a path integral. But everything looks completely traditional. It's like the usual kind of path integral. The usual kind of path integral, the kind we have for a scalar field. Local action up to the exponent with lots of fields. The price we've paid, by the way, is that we've introduced many new fields into the world. Okay? We've introduced the B field, the little B field, the C field, and the capital B field. Okay? Remember, all of this was just a mathematical trick. The original path integral was in terms of these A's. The Hilbert space is entirely created out of the A's, as we've discussed. Just as a mathematical trick to compute that original path integral, which had a clear Hilbert space interpretation as we've discussed, that sometimes it's useful to introduce more fields. Okay, there is an interesting... Okay, let me say one more thing. By the way, you know, there are more manipulations you can do here to get these alpha cases. We'll get to that when we... Okay, we'll get to that. It's all the essential ideas. Okay. The Hilbert space of this, you know, there is an interesting way of regarding the Hilbert space of the full problem. Okay. Now, if you look at this path integral, suppose somebody had to know where it came from. Just gave you the path integral and asked you to analyze the Hilbert space of this path integral.
Sir, all these fields which we have introduced obviously follow this algebra, right? Like the commutator algebra which we started off with. So, like, can we somehow introduce some field which doesn't follow this?
I didn't answer. What was the commutator algebra?
I mean, for example, like, all of these fields can be written as, say, B field can be written as DA, TA. So, that TA, TB, delta AB algebra is followed, right?
Yes.
So my question is, like, can we introduce some field like which does not follow this algebra? Like, that something
well, you know, we were introducing fields for a reason. It wasn't just by hand. Of course, you know, in this case, I won't say no to your question, but I'm just saying that we weren't doing things just for fun. Right? I mean, we were introducing things for a reason and we were led to this. Now, given any integral, there's an infinite amount of manipulations you can do that will not change the integral. So there may be other interesting things to do. I won't say no. But, okay. Fine. Now look, suppose you just looked at this path integral. Okay? You looked at this path integral and you tried to give a Hilbert space interpretation. You would at first say, okay, maybe you would not give, you would see, of course, that this B here has no kinetic term. And so it's somehow some sort of Lagrange multiplier field. But you would be tempted to associate a Hilbert space to this problem. You'd be tempted to associate a Hilbert space to this problem in which all the A fields have the promoted operators. Okay. All the B, little B and C fields are promoted operators. So you might be tempted to think that the whole problem was the Hilbert space was wave functionals of all four capital A's, little B, little C, subject to one constraint and other products. A B field. And that of course is totally wrong. Okay? Because that was not the original Hilbert space of the problem. That's not what we started trying to do. Now that it was totally wrong, you will see in many ways. Okay? You will see, for instance, that this problem, that if you try to give such an interpretation, the Hilbert space would not get an interpretation with a unit. You would not be able to get an interpretation that was both, where the physics was both unitary and energy bounded. Okay. And there are many sources of this problem. First is the A0 thing that we talked about, right? Okay. The second source is the fact that we've introduced anti-commuting fields to the problem. Even though these anti-commuting fields transform under Lorentz transformations like scalars. I think we'll discuss in more detail in this course as we go along. Well, there are very few general theorems about quantum field theory that not specifically about the quantum field theory in particular. But there's one simple general theorem called the spin statistics theorem. It says that if you want to get good theory, you know, theory that obeys certain conditions, there's a connection between the spin and the statistics of all fields of the theory. And that if you've got anti-commuting fields, they have to transform in spin-oriented representations. So that's good. In commuting fields, they have to transform in vectorial, by which I mean a representation that can be built out of taking direct products of vectors. Okay. So this thing here violates the spin statistics theorem if we are naive. Because it's anti-commuting by the scalar. And it's going to give us Hilbert space control. Okay? But there is an elegant way of restricting the naive Hilbert space that you get by quantizing this bigger path integral to a consistent subset. Okay? And that subsector matches with the Hilbert space that we were originally interested in. Then, an interesting way is called BRSD quantization. And we'll describe this perhaps by the end of this class, more likely at the beginning of the next class. But in preparation for that, we want to go away from these slightly formal discussions to other things. More general things about path integrals, and then come back to this point. Okay, so this was just a little appetizer for what's going to come. We're going to move away from these formal considerations to something slightly more concrete. What's a formal? Yeah. Any questions about it?
Do we say anything about the nature of these B fields, capital B?
Yeah, these capital B fields are clearly Lagrange multiplier fields. Because they don't have kinetic. Okay? And of course, one could. Okay. If one were naively doing this quantization, okay? I think even in a naivest procedure, what you would do is to make a Hilbert space for all the other guys and then try to implement the constraint that you get out of the B integral as a constraint of Hilbert space. Very much like A0 in our correct interpretation of But you know, that attempt is going to be wrong for many reasons. But there is a correct subset of which we will discuss. It's a very elegant way of thinking, very useful when we try to understand many things about gauge theory, for instance, the normalization of the scheme. So we come to it. But before we get there, in preparation for that, there are a few other things that we want to discuss.
This B or C fields, if all the three fields were, get the operator status, then in the Hilbert space interpretation, the states corresponding to B or C fields, can we show that these are somehow unphysical, or
yes?
Well, after we have to know that these we don't we shouldn't contain these fields in the theory.
It's a very good question. Firstly, of course, a priori we know, right? Because that's what we talked about. But as we discussed, suppose somebody just gave you this perfect thing and try to make a physics theory out of it that respects all the usual rules, okay? It's unitarity is energy bound from below. By doing the ninth thing, you'd have trouble, as we discussed. Okay? So you would have to do something in addition to this ninth. Either you would conclude that this Spartan tetral is no good for this. Because if you worked on the Spartan tetral, you would get a Hilbert space that included B and C also, excitations. But since we violated the spin statistics theorem, something will go wrong. Either unitarity or energy bound, or maybe both. Okay? Similarly with AC. Something's going to go wrong. Okay? And the thing that goes wrong, something's going to go badly. Okay? Now, there is a way of thinking of this property. I will describe this to you basically by the end of this class. But there's a way of thinking of this problem that identifies some subsector in this naive Hilbert space, which is isomorphic in every sense, every physics sense, to the actual Hilbert space of the problem. Namely, the square integrable of the wave functionals or EIs, subject to the gauge of the instrument. Okay? So, if you did the naive thing, you'd see trouble. But there's a way of fixing that, even on its own terms. Okay, without referring to what we knew the answer to be. Would you hang on with your question till after we discuss BRST? BRST quantization is the answer to the question. Okay, other questions or comments? Okay, let's move on. So we're happy with this Pati Popov thing. And this basically ends our first brush with path integrals. Okay? We have discussed in some, and as yet very formal way, because we've not computed anything. Okay? We've discussed in some, as yet very formal way, how every field theory we're going to encounter in this course can be written in terms of a path integral, also in semi practical terms. Okay? But before we proceed with further formal analysis, if you didn't already know the answer to this question, which I suspect many of you do, some of you would be wondering, what is all this? This is a lot of formal stuff. Sounds like you pronounced a mathematics course, except that the mathematicians won't accept it because it's not like this. So it belongs to no course. you're doing this playground with these integrals. What can you compute using these integrals? What physical quantity of interest can we compute using path integrals? And of course the answer is many physical quantities of interest. This is why they're useful. Okay? But let's start with the discussion of the simple solids. Okay. For the purposes of this our restarting the discussion of path integrals, let's go back to our original problem, quantum mechanics, one particle dimension. Okay? And you remember we had this lovely formula, which said that x f is bar minus I t psi was equal to dx exponential of I s. With the right boundary conditions. And this was our starting point in our understanding of path integrals. Now, I'm going to ask the following question. Suppose instead of this path integral here, I have a modified path integral where I compute a path integral weighted by the values of fields at various times. Okay? Suppose I compute a path integral dx, and then f of x of t1, f of x of t2, x1, x2, fn of x of t1, e to power I x. Suppose I compute this path integral. I'm being asked, what is the left hand side corresponding to this right hand side? You understand, we have this right hand side here, which is an integral, which computes the matrix elements of this evolution of it. Okay, already useful. Okay? But now I'm going to just take this right hand side and deform it in a way that from the point of view of integrals is quite natural. Okay? We think of the action as a measure. We're giving some sort of measure in some space. And now instead of just computing the volume of that space, subject to boundary conditions, we will compute averages of quantities weighted by that measure. From the point of view of doing integrals, quite a natural subject, quite a natural thing to do. Question, do we compute anything interesting on the left hand side? Do we compute anything interesting on the left hand side with this procedure? Okay. So by the way, of course, you know, when I started this question of what are these path integrals good for, somebody could have said they're good for computing transition amplitudes. And that's of course true. But as you will see in our study of quantum field theory, these transition amplitudes are complicated and really of interest in themselves. We're often interested in computing simpler things than transition amplitudes, which is where this is. Because the transition amplitudes depend on some wave functional here, wave functional there. And don't die. Okay, we could compute them. But we're just computing something. Okay. Yeah. So now, does anyone have a suggestion for what this would be? Of course, all of you know the answers. Suggestion. but let's build this up. So I will ask you. You see, it's very simple. Because if you go back to the derivation of the part, you will see that what's going on is the following. Let me call this Tf minus Ta. Okay, just to make the formula a little more symmetric. And then, as you know, this is the starting point of this way of thinking of path integrals. Tf minus Ti can be rewritten as e to the power minus I h tf minus tf times e to the power minus I h tn minus tn minus 1. So on until we get to e to the power minus I h t1 minus ti. Correct. Okay. That this is an equivalent. Okay? Now, each of these operators is generated by a path integral of this action subtype. Okay? And, you know, by putting a complete set of states in between here, we sew up these different path integrals. So, what we've done here is break up the path integral into a path integral over a segment from Ti to T1, T1 to T2. Each of these are path integral. And to get the full path integral, we also have to do that the integrals of x of T1, x of T2, and so on. Okay? But now, suppose that I want to find the interpolation of this, the integral with these insertions. There's a clear way to do it. Suppose, in between these things, I put these f's. So suppose here I put f1 of x. Here I put, in the next place I put f2 of x. And then finally here I put fn of x. Then can you see that if we repeated our path integral derivation, we would get the right hand side as the answer. You see, because in each of these places we are putting completeness. That integral, in terms of full path integral, was the integral of f x at t1. But because we're going to complete the summary and this guy acting on the basis vector, will give us f1 of x at t1. Similarly, we get f2 of x at t2. That's all. Okay? So if we were interested in computing, so this integral computes this object from an inverse perspective. Is this clear? Any questions or comments? Okay, and what does the computer take the initial state, evolve to time t1, put this operator f1 of x. Then evolve to time t2, put the next operator, f2, and so on. Is this totally clear? Questions or comments? Now, this looks like a pretty ugly formula. Okay? Allow me to change this to some psi and this to some chi.
Sir, I just want to clarify on the left hand side, these f's are operators, on the right hand side, they are functions. Right?
Yes.
So, like, all these are kind of eigenstates.
Not eigenstates, these are matrix elements. Because some product of operators are getting matrix elements. Expect one. Some state some. Is this clear? Allow me to change this x and y, x star to xf to psi and chi. What we would now then have to do is, of course, add the extra convolutions to this path integral in the right, as we've discussed. And we'll have to do a path integral also over the initial and final x's, weighted by the wave functions, as we've discussed. Okay, just to make the discussion a bit clear. Okay, now, so far we've been using what people call the Schrodinger picture when we discuss the left hand side. But there's also this other famous picture called the Heisenberg picture, which is much less natural to think about when you're studying quantum mechanics. In a quantum mechanics course, it's like some side issue. But somehow it's often the most convenient way of thinking of quantum field. Okay, so let me remind you of this, the Schrodinger picture. The Heisenberg picture and quantum mechanics. Okay. First, let me remind you of how Schrodinger picture works. The Schrodinger picture, we've got some state psi, let's say at time t equals 0. That's called psi 0. And then psi t is e to the minus I h t times psi 0. Operators are operators, they're not functions of time. X, the operator X, it's some matrix in Hilbert space, and it's that matrix forever. Okay, this is the Schrodinger picture, which is of course conceptually clear as pretty much. However, Heisenberg noted the following, or Dirac noted that what Heisenberg was doing was equivalent to what Schrodinger was doing because of the following fact.
That, Schrodinger, the operators are focusing sometimes. Yeah, you call it UTU.
UT is a function of time, you're right. But what I meant was like these operators X and P. Okay? The basic the basis operator. Yes, you can define operators. But the basis operators X and T. The guys that obey this kind of combination. Right? No. Okay. So there are some operators. Yeah, let's just talk about X. X and P are just now. If we're interested only in computing, matrix elements of operators, okay, then when the Heisenberg picture defines psi Heisenberg as equal to pi h times psi Schrodinger. And this definition is done to undo the time difference. So psi Heisenberg is psi Schrodinger at t equals 0. And it's not a function of time. Okay. But then every operator, Heisenberg operator, is defined as the Schrodinger operator. You know, the same function of x's and
times it's per month I actually consider power.
Okay, and this is done in such a way so that obviously pi at t2 psi at t1 said something. Let's say that suppose we want to compute matrix elements. Suppose we want to compute matrix elements of some product of operators between some states at some time. We get the same answer whether we're working with Schrodinger states and Schrodinger operators, or Heisenberg states and Heisenberg operators. Just because the difference between these two all cancel out. And because we've got a state which has this additional factor, but then the first insertion of the operator will have this additional factor, then to the left and so on. We'll just keep canceling. Right? So in computing matrix elements, you can equally well work with these objects. That was the reason for the definition of these objects. Okay? Now that we have the definition, we take the definition of its own terms. Okay? And deal with it. So, the first thing we're going to ask is, what is the left-hand side for this object in the Heisenberg picture? Okay? So let's see, we knew the Schrodinger picture what it was. In the Schrodinger picture, this object was e to the power I h minus I t f minus t I. By the way, I started dropping h bar. I noticed. You'll excuse that. In the first lecture, you saw lots of h bars. Last one. This was the Schrodinger representation of the left-hand side. But now, we just add the e to the power plus iti of this guy. And the e to the power minus its on that guy. And remember, we're acting to the left. That involves a complex conjugation. A Hermitian conjugation. So can you see that this is the same as chi Heisenberg and psi? You see, this problem, of course, knows about t2 and t1. How does it know about T21? It is these two guys. What are they? This is the Heisenberg wave function for the state that in Schrodinger representation was psi at time t1. Again, or this is the Heisenberg wave function for the state which in Schrodinger representation was chi at time t2. Let's be a little clearer. You see, in computing this path integral, we have to convolute the path integral with some psi and some chi. That psi and that chi will not be the wave functions that appear here. Because we are asked to convolute by the Schrodinger wave functions at that time. Okay? So the time dependence comes in the translation between what you convolute with and what these states are. The translation is given by the formulas of this translation. And it is of course a translation of evolution. Okay? So this notation here has both time dependencies implicit in it. Okay? So psi h. What was it in terms of Schrodinger language? Was psi times e to the power I h. So clearly it depends.
So should I name it as H comma D1?
You can do that. It's psi H is this, yes, let's call it H. Let's do it. Okay.
So what is the matter of
small steps?
Yes.
You have introduced these steps.
Yes.
So what are these correspond to the original question?
Yeah, so we answered this in Schrodinger representation. Did you understand that answer? Now we are going to answer it in Heisenberg. If that's the question, that's the question.
Now, what does this correspond to the original transition amplitude?
This is the answer here. You see, the original transition amplitude was just inner product between two states of e to the power iht. Right? Now, if we didn't have these f still, we'll go back to the original problem. What corresponds to the original transition is breaking this up and putting F, F, F. That's the answer. Is it clear?
Yeah, I'm asking even before that. Before dividing into the steps.
Huh?
What does this correspond to?
No, it corresponds to nothing. The question you should be asking is what is the Hilbert space interpretation? And you've got an integral. And what is the Hilbert space interpretation? There must always be an answer to that. A Hilbert space interpretation is all for a number. It's always inner product between two states of some operating assertions. So what I have to identify for you is what operating assertions. And I've done that. There's no further answer to your question. Any other questions or comments? Okay. Now, so what we've concluded, if you follow carefully our discussion, is that this object, the guy that involves this, is chi Heisenberg T2, psi Heisenberg T1, okay, times F1 of x of T1. I have to put a time here, because the Heisenberg operators are functions of time. Okay, F2 of x of t2, fn of x of t2. Okay, there are two ways of writing this. Either you could have written this as f2 of x, comma t2, or the function of x of t2, because there's no explicit time dependence on the operator. These are the same. So I've chosen to write this so that the x field at t1, function of that. Okay? So, this is the Hilbert space interpretation. This is the Hilbert space interpretation. This part, the integral with the insertions. Is this clear? Yes. This is time order, you see, because the way we've written it, look at this, T1 was smaller than T2, was smaller than Tn, and because we had to break up the evolution operators first to T1, then to T2, T1 came here, T2 came here, T3 came here, and so on. So the way I've written it, it is automatically time. Is this clear? Okay, that was going to be actually my next comment. The comment is that you will often see this thing written in the following way. If this is chi ht2, time order of f1x of t1, f2 x of t2, fn x. What does this time ordered operation mean? It means put the earliest operator to the right, the next earliest operator just next to it, and so on. So this is just a fancy way of rewriting this. Okay, and within this time order, of course, I could put this in any order. Because time order tells you what order to put that product of operators. So I wasn't careful about writing F1 to the right. Is this clear? Fine.
Sir, is there some way to write this psi and chi in terms of a vacuum? Then maybe we can compute those correlation functions.
Yeah, okay. Psi and chi at this point are completely arbitrary. Okay? And maybe you'll like to think of it as some operator in the back. But hang on, you're waiting to try and generate perturbation theory. Wait a
minute.
Very good question. Very good question. You see, firstly, these, the most general weighted expression for an integral is this. Okay. So for the path integral, there's nothing more left to compute. Okay. So now if you've got functions of p, it must be that there's some translation formula. Functions of p in the... So there's no question of what a function of p in the integral side. Because the integral is not a... There are no p's in the integral. However, on the operator side, of course, you can have functions of p. You can have operators that were functions of p. So you could ask, suppose instead of putting these time ordered expressions here, suppose I had operators that were also functions of p, then what would happen? And the answer is that in doing the path integral over p, you would effectively generate some function of x. Let me give you a simple example. But you see, yeah, you can have derivatives with respect to time in the integral, but there's no sense in which you can have d by d. X is just an integral. Okay? Let me give you an example. Let's look at the insertion of the operator p. Now, can you tell me what you would expect the operator p to become? Suppose our action was... expect the integral p to become. This is natural. Mx dot. Because p is mx dot. Okay? That's what you should expect it to become. That's zero. That's zero. True. Okay. Suppose we've got p inserted at some time. Okay. Now, what we have is let's say we're interested in computing. You know, we're doing this one step of the path integral. So x n plus 1. Okay? Now let's say I'm doing it in Schrodinger. I'm just doing the that one set of the puzzle. X n plus 1 e to the power minus I h delta t and x n. Okay? And suppose in this I put an insertion of the operator. Okay, so if I do this, then let me now work out, then redo the derivation of the path integral with this insertion. As you remember, because the delta t was very small, we could put, h was p squared by 2n plus v of x, we could write that equally as e to the power v of x on the left, p squared plus 2 on the right, and we could insert x plus 1, e to the power minus I, h minus I, v of x delta t times p e to the power minus v squared by 2n delta t times e to the power minus I h delta t.
Then that linear term is just replaced by the solution to the equations of motion of the Gaussian integral.
because the solution to the equations of motion of this Gaussian integration was x is equal to b. Okay, so we have this x term here. We just replace this x by the solution to the equation of motion. That is the minimum of the exponent. It's a general rule for Gaussian integrals. I've worked it out to remind you for one variable, but it's always true. Okay? So here now we can apply the same. What is the solution? So we've got this b. What is the solution to the equation? What is the equation of motion that comes from the numerator? Well, it is that p by 2m, by m, delta with a minus I plus I x dot delta q is equal to 0. And now the p is equal to x dot m x. As you would have expected. Remember, it won't be so simple for p squared. Because in the quantum theory, p square is not the square of p. I mean, the expectation value of matrix elements of p square are not the square of the matrix elements of p. So you shouldn't expect that p square will be mx dot, will result in the replacement mx dot square, the whole thing square. That won't be the case. Okay? Each operator is its own beast. But it will always be the case that some insertion of momentum is an effective insertion of x and x. Okay? So, if actually it's to avoid answering this question that I need to answer the question the forward way. And I could have asked the question, what are time order expectation values in the path integral? And then I knew this question would come. But you forced me. But you see, if I ask the backward way the question, doesn't arise. Okay? Because if we ask the question from the path integral, it's an integral, the integral over x, there's no p. Okay? Of course, there's an answer. But if you want to work out time ordered expressions of p's by themselves, written that way, okay, you have to do more work. You have to find out what the effective insertion is. And then proceed. And it turns out that in quantum field theory, we'll never want to do this. Because when we do quantum field theory, we work, as you will see, more from this Lagrangian than the Hamiltonian point of view. So we will never need more than insertion. I don't know, never, never say never, but most things that you see in textbooks, you don't need the insertion of these pieces. So you won't even get into this issue. Okay, good.
So after all, means after we have integrated over the p, we can always put what we get in the numerator as some potential. And like.
Enumerator meaning this down here, right? Or up there?
Up there. Sorry, the exponential is some. Sorry,
okay.
As some potential. So we can always find some other action for which is in these p insertions work is a.
That's correct. In this particular case, that other action would be log of x dot, if you want to put it up in the exponent. Okay. You can think of it that way, but it's most natural not to if the insertion is downstairs. Let me say it another way. Suppose you had generating function for insertions of p. Suppose you wanted to put e to the power I alpha dot p. So it's naturally exponentially dependent. Then that's a very natural way to think. Okay? You could if the thing is downstairs, you can still think that way. It's less natural. You can think of this as a Taylor expansion of that. Okay, so I agree with you. But fine, maybe I have. Is there something else you want?
No, the point I was trying to make was like when you said that we can forget about the P, it's
yes.
P insertion.
Yes.
Means what I was trying to convey.
No, you were trying to explain that fact.
As in we can always have some other Lagrangian in which the same problem can happen.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. You're absolutely right. So you see that from there, you see. That's the integration. That's effectively what we did here with the thing that makes sense. You're absolutely right. Thank you. Okay. Any other questions or comments? What? On the integral side we can have arbitrary functions of x of t.
X dot.
But x dot is a function of x of t. Because x dot is x of t plus epsilon minus x of t divided by epsilon. So when I say that you can have an arbitrary function of x at every time, in particular, it could of course have x. Is this clear? In fact, this is what it means. This is what x dot means inside the bucket. But x dot always means in particular. Okay. Other questions about this? Okay, excellent. So now we have understood that the path integral is pretty good at computing one set of observables apart from transition amplitudes. It's pretty good at computing amplitudes, weighted, you know, amplitudes between two given states of time order operator insertions. Okay? Actually, the path integral is not very good. Well, it has to be modified if you want to compute other ordinates. Suppose I have the insertions of three operators, times t1, t2, and t3, and I wanted to put those operators not in time order but in some crazy way. Okay? Then, what I would have to do is to evolve up to the time of the insertion. Then evolve back in time to get the next insertion. And then evolve forward in time again to get the third insertion and go on. So, I could still do this by a path integral, but a path integral that loops back in time. Do you understand this? It's a funny contour. Actually, it's something that's sometimes useful. Called Schwinger in thermal context. In context of equilibrium, non-equilibrium, statistical mechanics. Called Schwinger-Keldysh kind of path. Keldysh path integral. Okay. For thermal physics. And we may have the time to discuss such issues. Okay? However, the most natural path integrals, the most natural operator expectation values computed in path integral language are these time operators. Okay, so any quantity that is easily expressed from time ordered insertions of operators is very naturally reproducible in path integrals. Okay? In particular, if we wanted to do these funny guys, we would have to choose a different integration contour for every observable. Go forward and then back and forward. Maybe do zigzags n times for the n operator. Okay? Time order, guys, is just one contour of this. Okay. Great. So now that we understand what we can compute so nicely, using these path integrals, we're going to examine some properties of these insertions inside path integrals and discover some nice things. Okay. The first thing we're going to see is how the equation of motion works inside a path. You know, I should have said this, I suppose, but it's obviously the path integral is one clear way, actually a very good way, of making connection between quantum and classical physics. Okay? Because the structures that appear inside the path integral are the structures of classical mechanics, namely the action. As we've seen, as I mentioned before, you know, the stationary phase approximation in the limit of h bar goes to 0, the stationary phase approximation would tend to tell you that you have that the path that dominates is the classical trajectory, the path that extremizes the action. Okay? And from this point of view, all of the structures of classical physics should somehow find some sort of role, perhaps a modification in the quantum theory. Okay? And that is, of course, very natural quantity in classical physics. Okay? And very natural structure in classical physics. That's the equation of motion, the thing that you get by varying the action. Okay? So we're going to ask. By the way, everything that we said for quantum mechanics generalizes without any ado to the field theory part of the textbooks we're studying. Is this clear? These operator insertions, time order. No issues. Okay. By the way, another thing that you might, one of you might worry about the following. One of you might worry about how could it be, how can this possibly work for one way? Because time ordering depends on how you slice the path. But by different time orderings, I can get different by different slicings, I can get different time orderings. Let me say this again. What is the generalization of our, let me work this out for a scalar. What is the generalization of what we just computed? The scalar. So in the scalar field theory, we've got Heisenberg operators, phi of x, even Schrodinger operators were labeled by x. But now these are functions also of t. These are functions of x. This is, by the way, why Heisenberg pictures are natural in quantum field theory. Because it removes this distinction between space and time. Operators are labeled not just by position, but also by time in some way. Naturally. Anyway, so we've got these guys, and generalization of what we found is that state, time order of, let's say, functions of, but let's say, simply the dumb, is phi of x, mu 1, phi of x, mu 2, phi of x, mu n, is equal to the integral dx, phi s, phi of x, mu 1, is this clear? Okay. Now this looks like a great formula until you start thinking about it. Because when you start thinking about it, it sounds like it makes no sense. Because in order to get you see, these operators are just operators. Okay? But you can ask, in what slicing is this statement true? Okay? Because, suppose you've got some operators here. Suppose I've got T and X, let's say in one dimension, nothing depends on Y and Z. I've got some insertion that's here, here, and here. But this guy is before this guy is before this guy. But by boosting, I can go to a frame where this guy is before this guy, for instance. And you can change the order of the time order of events in special relativity by boosting. Okay? So how could this possibly be true? Because it's not giving you an unambiguous ordering. What is the answer to this question? Exactly. This is consistent because, as we will analyze in more detail, you've already studied this before, but we will analyze from our own point of view in more detail to go on the course. There are operators that are space-like separated necessarily commute. What is the simple argument for this?
So causality.
Okay, causality. But I mean, how do you know that this is true? You bring the theory, causality, but from the way you construct quantum field theory. From the way you construct quantum field theory, it's true, because if two operators are space-like separate, you can always go to a frame where they're at the same time. And your construction of quantum field theory introduces a separate Hilbert space for each point in space on a given time slice. Okay? Operators that act on distinct Hilbert spaces obviously commute. Okay? So, from the construction, the basic construction of quantum field theory, it's clear that operators at space-like separated points commute with each other. Okay? So this ambiguity is not there. Okay, great. So this generalization of quantum field theory is rather clear. Okay? Because of this nice additional feature, structure of quantum field theory. Okay, but now what we can do is to try to understand, as we said, this equation of motion. So, what we're going to see is where we can write down some equation that acts on these correlators. You write down an equation. These objects are often called correlators. Okay? Time-ordered products of operator insertions. Okay. We write an insertion, an equation that acts on correlators in the following way. Suppose I have a path integral like this, like the one I've written down here, and I modify it in the following way. I take whatever's on the right-hand side. Okay, I take whatever's on the right-hand side and differentiate it with respect to x of x. Is what I'm going to do here. This path integral here is a separate path integral. This path integral here is a separate path integral for phi at each spacetime. Okay. So in particular, as a function of phi at some spacetime point x, this integral, this everything here is a function of phi at every spacetime point, in particular phi at x, and I take a total derivative of that object with respect to phi at x. Now, if all our path integrals are convergent, we discuss this a little more when we discuss analytic continuation of these path integrals. Probably not this class, but definitely the next class. Okay? If all our integrals are convergent, you might expect that the integral of a total derivative vanishes. So you only get boundary contributions. The boundary contributions are infinity, and if things are infinity, contribute to all integrals. So, so the whole path integral way of thinking will only make sense when things are at infinity. No matter. Okay? So, this thing had better be zero. Okay? So we're going to start with the assumption that any set way of giving sense to this path integral, making sense of this path integral, will set this object to be zero. But now let's break up what this object is. This is integral d phi of. Now this derivative is just an ordinary derivative. That's an ordinary function there. It obeys the Leibniz rule. Okay? So, what are the various terms here? We have e to the minus is, and then there are various terms. One is when this acts on the s. Plus i. Okay. So, I times del s by del phi of s. What is the other name for this object? Equation of motion. The variation of the action with respect to a field is the equation of motion. Okay?
Phi at x1 nu, phi at xn.
That's one term. And then we have other terms when this hits all of these. But of course, phi of x and phi of x prime are distinct variables. Okay? So by the rules of functional derivatives, right, this will become delta of x minus x1, delta d of x minus x1, times phi of x2, I'm not putting a new sign, plus phi of x1, delta x minus x2, phi of x3, n such terms. Is this clear? Now, let us invent a name, okay? This path integral with appropriate initial and final states, whatever they are, I'll just denote by this expectation of whatever insertions I have. So what we concluded that
y times del s by del phi of x,
phi of x,
one,
phi of x, again.
Well, let me take the I out and take the other stuff to the right hand side. Is equal to, now I took to the right hand side, I've got minus 7 multiplied with the I step, plus I times n is equal to 1, m is equal to 1 to n, delta of x minus x, m, phi of x1, phi of xn, with the 1 removed, being the phi. I don't know how to write this. Product of those n minus 1 phi is phi x1. Expectation. Okay? And that's a beautiful equation. What does the equation tell you? It tells you that if you've got an insertion of the equation of motion, and many, okay, let's look at what this tells you itself.
Constraint, right? Like when we give the equation of motion, we are putting a constraint on one of the things. So that comes as a delta function on the right. It's a sum over all the things.
Hang on for a minute. Hang on for a minute. I don't think I completely agree with that. Hang on for a minute and then ask again. Let's look at the case where there were no insertions. Then what we get is exactly like classical physics. The object that is zero by the equation, you know, for a scalar field, this del s by del phi couldn't be del squared plus m squared phi. Zero. So, right. So this would, for instance, be that. Okay? This is exactly like in classical physics, that the insertions obey, insertions inside the path integral, obey the equations. On the other hand, when you've got, let's now look at the case where you have one insertion. Okay? First let's look at it abstractly and then we'll discuss it. How are you placed with 10 or 15 minutes extension? This class is okay, great. So now let's look at the case where we have one insertion. So we've got expectation value of del s by del phi of x, and let's say phi of phi, is equal to I times delta of x minus y, then you remove the phi of x minus y. So expectation value. Yeah, please. Okay. Now, this is a prediction of this path integral way of thinking. And I want to ask you whether this worries you. Does it worry you that del s by del phi of x is not just zero, irrespective of which insertion? Why is this happening? Why do we get this delta function del phi of x? Now, why should you expect that del s by del phi x is zero? You might expect it because, as you probably know, in the Heisenberg picture, the equation of motion holds as an operator equation. At least naively, if we don't remember sessions. This you know. You know, right? Alright, okay. So if it holds as an operator equation, why isn't it always true? Why are these anomalies? If you've got an operator that's zero, so you replace it by zero inside any equation. So, within path integrals, this is a question, it is what it is. But we had a Hilbert space interpretation. Okay? We have a Hilbert space interpretation of this object. How could it be that this, in that Hilbert space interpretation, this was not just zero, because in the Dilbert's interpretation involved an expectation of an operator that naively should have been zero. Suggestions? But in the Hilbert space formulation, we had an exact operator. Exact operator statement that was, for instance, suppose we are in quantum mechanics.
Sir,
let me just finish this. Yeah, the claim was that as the Heisenberg operator is this equation. This you can prove. Please, go on.
In the Heisenberg picture, I think at a particular time it's zero. So the delta function basically implies that, you know, if we go at that time, then
we are operating in a commutator. So I square and a phi on the same commutator relation.
I square. What am I square? I still haven't understood. You see, we are supposed to be integrating the tiny force of some operator. Let's be specific. Let's suppose that our equation of motion, let's write down our action. S was equal to m phi dot del mu phi, the minus sign because we use the mostly positive. Okay. Plus, by 2, plus m squared, minus m squared, phi squared, by 2. So let's be concrete. And this will help. Let's compute what this del S by del phi. So what is del S by del phi? Well, here I get something that I integrate by parts. The integration by parts will kill the minus sign. So we'll give me del squared phi, no minus, del squared minus m squared phi. So what we're claiming is the following. We're claiming that integral d phi of l squared minus m squared phi of x phi of e to the power I s is equal to delta function. That's the concrete thing. Okay. Now, what does it mean to have this del squared minus m squared inside that path integral? You see, it means something very simple. We've got an insertion at phi of x. Okay? We've got an insertion phi of y. This is the derivative with respect to x. So what this means is, you know, without this, this is some number, it's a function of x and y. And we differentiate some function of x and y, and we differentiate that function. Okay? So it's clear, its meaning is clearest to find if you take this out. Thanks, this function of x and y. Because all we're doing is integrating. Okay? Yeah. Now this is really clearly stated. Now this is equal to, this is the claim. Now let's look at the Hilbert space interpretation of the left hand side. Let's write it down carefully. So what was it? It was expectation value of time order of phi of x, phi of y, on state is equal to I delta phi of y. Right. That's the claim with the del squared insertion. That's the Hilbert space claim. Okay. Now, you might ask, how could this be because this operator just kills phi squared x? It's true, it kills phi x. But we have to be very careful here because this is time. Okay? Time order mean? Let's write it out as a formula. So time order means the following. It means the guy that's earlier goes to the right. lambda of x0 minus y0 phi x phi y plus theta of y0 minus x0 phi y phi. So explicitly you've got del x squared minus m squared. Now this is equal to I delta of x. Is this clear? Now we see that it's far from clear that the left hand side vanishes. Okay? Now we see it's far from clear that the left hand side vanishes, because while this does vanish when acting on phi of x, it doesn't vanish when acting on the theta function. In particular, the time derivatives here acting on these theta functions, the time derivatives here acting on these theta functions give rise to delta functions. Hey, just in time. Okay, but delta functions. Okay. I'm not going to leave the following as an exercise for you. Exercise. Compute this thing. Use the equation of motion for y-x. So, what that gives you is that these guys acting on these two are just zero. What it leaves behind is either one time derivative acting on the thetas, and one time derivative acting on phi of x, or both time derivatives acting on the thetas. A, show that the term with both time derivatives acting on the thetas cancels. B, show that the term with one time derivative acting on the theta and one time derivative acting on phi of x does not cancel, but instead it's proportional to phi of x dot commutator phi of x. C, use the canonical commutation relations. Because you call it times delta of x. C, use the canonical commutation relations to turn this into a full Fourier. More or less sketched out how it works for you. I'm going to ask you to complete this. Is it clear? Is the sequence of steps clear to you? You'll have to check each of these steps. Anyone? Unclear to anyone? Okay? Great. So, even from the Hilbert space point of view, this equation is true. Okay? It comes out quite effortlessly using the path integral. This was, of course, a simple case, a simple example. So we could argue it quite easily either way. But there are some equations that are much easier to deduce from path integral ways of thinking than other Hilbert space ways of thinking. And you will start thinking about this. Okay? This, by the way, generalizes completely to many more insertions, because then there are many more theta functions. Okay? It's exactly the same logic from this. Hilbert space point of view, can be used to derive the full formula that we have. Try it. Okay?
What is the physical,
what's going on is that the observable that you're computing changes discontinuously when the times of two operators are
switched.
Because of the time. Okay? And that discontinuous change happens at a particular time. So when you differentiate in the state of time, it hits that. That's basically it. Is this clear?
The equation of motion on the left side is equal to some delta function source on the right side.
Yes, it's the equation. We're going to interpret this exactly like that, just one. Okay, but is the Hilbert space interpretation, I'm going to leave this as an exercise for you people. Okay, by the way, I think I'll send you an email sometime in the middle of this week asking you to do a few exercises for submission. Okay, I think we'll make this one. Can I request somebody to make note of these exercises when I ask your help? Now, could I ask you to write down? Okay, but I'll just ask you your help in remembering these exercises. Okay. Okay, there's just one thing I wanted to do, and then I'll let you people go. I'm sorry, I take extra class each, extra time each day. Okay. No, no good excuse. Now what we're going to try to do is to, is what you were asking, is to try to use this equation in a particular case. And the equation that we had, let's use it for insertion of, you know, the one, the first non-trivial case. So we got the equation del x squared minus x squared on phi of x, phi of y is equal to I del delta of now, it's often used, this equation can be thought of as a differential equation for the two-point function. Phi by 5y, time order, something called the two-point function. And this gives us a differential equation whose solution terms are two-point functions. Okay? Notice, by the way, that we're working the free theory. The abstract analysis that I talked about, where this was del s by del phi, was true for anything. But when I replaced del s by del phi by x squared minus m squared, I'm now working the free theory. I haven't included the possibility of, let's say, phi to the 4. Okay. If I did include the possibility of a phi to the 4 coupling, what would I get? I would get del squared minus m squared of the two-point function is equal to some expression acting on a four-point function. Because you would have phi cube times phi. That's the reason we can solve. We're going to be able to... The reason we're going to be get this, this thing gives us a simple equation that we can just solve is that we work for the free thing. But still, it's usual. Okay. So, now let's look at this equation was here. In order to process this equation, let's take the following Fourier transform. This will always be the convention, of course. Whenever we take the Fourier transform, the momentum integral will always be accompanied by 2 pi to the power d in the denominator. But position integrals will not have anything. Okay, this one consistent convention. Some people prefer symmetric, but the quantum field theory is the most useful. Okay? This is just a definition of the Fourier transform of phi. Phi of x was an operator, one was, let's say, an operator insertion side of path integral. Phi of p is Fourier transformed operator, Fourier transformed insertion side of path integral. Definition. Okay, now, what does this equation become? This equation for, if we insert this up here, what do we get? Well, what do we get? Let's work it out once. E to the pi b dot x. Then we would get plus e to the power I p prime dot y. Okay? Phi of b prime. And then two of these integration factors, right? B by 2 pi d. B prime by 2 pi d. And then we've got this expression here. But this expression just becomes minus b squared minus x squared on this the integral. Is equal to whatever it was on the right side. We'll leave the right side. Okay, let's look at the left hand side. So, on the left hand side now, what do we have? Okay, okay. Let's also write down the right hand side.
So this is equal to I times. Now I'll also write that in Fourier transform space.
V squared minus M squared must also be inside V.
V squared minus M squared. So this guy is, I'll write an integral representation for this Lenka function. So I'll write this as, first I'll write it two steps. First I'll write pi d dot x minus y d dp by 2 pi pi d. This is, you know, the integral representation of the delta function. And then make this appear as similar as possible to that object. And write this as is equal to I e to pi p dot x plus I d prime dot y d d p by 2 pi bar d d p prime by 2 pi bar d prime into 2 pi to the power b, the delta of b plus b times. I know it's a perverse thing to do, but it's true, right?
The reason I've done this is that now I can completely compare these two expressions.
But there is an angular bracket.
What?
The
angular bracket. But you know, so we're interested in Fourier transforms of functions. The angular bracket defines some function. And so, since the two functions are equal, the Fourier transforms are equal. But I've just effectively have worked out the Fourier transforms in this language. So see the equation that we finally arrive at and see the equivalent. What we are concluding is that minus p squared plus m squared. Sorry. Minus p squared plus m squared times angular bracket phi of p prime. Is equal to r I times 2 pi to the power d times delta of p plus p. I still have the right. Okay? And this tells me by just by dividing. B by let me put a minus here to make this a little bit better. Is equal to I by the power of B delta of B minus right divided by either I lose a minus sign. So minus. Okay. So the solution to this equation tells us what our Green's function is in momentum space. It's 1 over p squared plus m squared with some spring things of minus I and to pies it out. Okay. Now I'm going to stop in just 1 minute. But somebody here should be, well, if you know this anyway, but anyway, somebody here should be raising an alarm bell. See, this is not completely clear. Okay. Actually, this step is completely clear. Going from there to there, I've divided by something that could somewhere become zero. Okay? And so this quantity here is, you know, totally well defined. Except when p squared plus m squared is equal to zero. That is, except when you're exactly on shell. Okay? So there is an issue about how. Firstly, whether this is true, and secondly, what it means. Whether this is true and what it means,
when p square goes on. Okay? All of you know the answer to this question. It's this famous Feynman I-epsilon business. But we will try to understand how this comes about from the point of view of path detected with Pythagorean experience. Okay? Yeah, so this was an example of the use of this. By the way, this equation of motion sometimes called Schwinger-like simulation. Okay? And quantum physics is full of Schwinger-like simulations. Just like classical physics is full of equations. Okay? We'll see. All right, we'll get used to these things. Okay, questions or comments? Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Friday's holiday. I see. Yeah, let's have class. Wednesday though, at 2:30 there is a talk I have. What about tomorrow? You have all class. 4 o'clock there's a talk I have for theory. What time? Wednesday morning?
Morning, what's it?
10 o'clock.
Class at 11:30.
11:30. Which clearly disqualifies your introduction. Okay, let's have the, if that's the only constraint, let's have the 10 o'clock class and we try to finish up. Which means on time. Yeah. Okay, is it Wednesday, 10 o'clock? Let's fix it.